Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Alternative History of Britain, The Anglo-Saxon Age, by Timothy Venning, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Introduction. One of the few dates from medieval British history still firmly in the popular memory is 1066. The end of Anglo-Saxon England and the Norman conquest are still viewed as major events, England's forcible first entry into Europe. Its somewhat isolated socio-political structure was integrated into the world of Western European, Latin-speaking Christendom, and what is loosely described as feudalism. The victor, Duke William of Normandy, known, though not to his face, as the Bastard, rather than the late sobriquet the Conqueror, had no serious claim on the throne, though he did his best to claim that the late King Edward, not known then as the Confessor, had named him as heir, and the intervening king, Harold Godwinson, was an oath-breaking usurper. The kings after the conquest numbered themselves as from 1066, not from English unification in the 1920s. Edward I, reigned 1272 to 1307, was in fact the fourth Edward to rule England, starting with the national unifier Edward the Elder, reigned 899 to 924. The work of the unification of England took place with the northwards expansion of the allied kingdoms of Edward's Wessex and his sister Ethelfleda's Mercia into the Danelaw, East Midlands and East Anglia, settled by Danish incomers in the 870s, in 911 to 18, and by 924, Edward was recognised as overlord by the Danish Kingdom of York and the Norse settlers in Lancashire. He secured Mercia too on his sister's death in 918, and York was incorporated into England in 927, though it subsequently revolted and was not finally annexed until 954. Cumbria, independent but linked to Strathclyde in Scotland, was partly overrun in 945, but modern Cumberland only appears to have been annexed in 1092. The shifting Anglo-Scottish border in the east moved south from the Forth to its present position in the 970s. The creation of a Kingdom of England was thus far from straightforward, and there was no tradition of a united Anglo-Saxon Kingdom of England, so Mercian and Northumbrian regional separatism remained an issue. Edward's annexation of Mercia in 918 was immensely aided by the fact that its heir, his niece, Egwin, was a girl who could not lead armies, and there was no male candidate available. Even so, his eldest son, Athelstan, brought up in Mercia and the offspring of a legally questionable marriage, was passed over for Wessex and seems to have been intended to rule Mercia. He only secured Wessex when his half-brother, Elfwerd, died weeks after Edward in 924. The fact that he was not crowned for a year implies serious resistance to this. Had Elfwerd not died, would England have remained united? Similarly, it is possible that Athelstan's half-brother and successor, Edmund, intended both his sons, Edwy and Edgar, to rule a kingdom each when they were adult. Edwy succeeded to both in 955, but in 957, Mercia and Northumbria revolted in Edgar's favour. Edwy's death in 959 saw unity restored, but was this inevitable? The succession to Edgar in 975 was disputed between partisans of his two underage sons, Edward and Ethelred, though division was avoided, and in 978, Edward was murdered. In the 1000s, England was gradually overrun by a Viking army under Svein Forkbeard, King of Denmark, a war that could have seen England split into two again, with him ruling the Danelaw and Northumbria, which were first to accept him. As Wessex rallied against the Danes under Athelred's son Edmund Ironside in 1016, the latter's defeat at Ashingdon saw England divided between him and Sven's son Canute, though this was probably only a truce born of exhaustion, and Edmund quickly died. A temporary division between the partisans of Canute's two sons, Harold Harefoot and Harthacnut Canute, followed Canute's death in 1035, though that was soon reversed, as first one, then the other took control, and in 1066, King Harold Hadradi of Norway endeavoured to add York, and perhaps more, to his wide-flung domains. After Harold was killed by Harold Godwinson, the latter fell in battle against Duke William within weeks, but a less decisive result could have left England divided again, as in 1016. The triumph of one state in England was far from certain throughout this period, and was due to genetic and military luck rather than inevitability. The what-ifs of English unification are thus many, and pose possibilities of a future for England radically different from reality. And what if the Wessex of Alfred the Great had succumbed to Viking invasion in the battle winter of 870-71, or the surprise attack of winter 877-78? What if Alfred, a fourth if not fifth son, had never been king? What if two heirs had succeeded in 924, 955-59, or 975? What if Edmund had defeated Canute in 1016? What if Canute had not died relatively young in 1035, or both his sons had not died in their 20s? What if Edward the Confessor had had a son, or his nephew and chosen heir, Edward the Exile, had not died in 1057? Earl Harold Godwinson would have stood little chance of the throne in either case, and Duke William even less. Events cast a long shadow. If the English elite had not been decimated by the Wars of the 1000s, and Canute's takeover, King Edward would not have had his political power circumscribed as of 1042 by three powerful earls, all nominees of Canute, who could call on more military resources than he could. Even if Harold's father, Godwin, had still been chief minister, as in reality, when Edward exiled him in 1051, he would have been unlikely to have fought his way back to power. And again, Harold would never have been in a position to succeed as king in 1066. The same applies to events before the Viking invasions, which began in 865, though here the evidence is less clear, particularly before circa 650, and much has to be guesswork. Basic questions of political and social development have to be asked. Why did pre-850 England consist of so many petty kingdoms, when the incoming Germanic peoples, conquerors or settlers, managed to create one state in Francia? The notion of a stable heptarchy of seven English kingdoms has now been disproved, and it is clear that there were three major states, Northumbria, Mercia and Wessex, plus numerous smaller ones, some of which were temporarily or permanently absorbed by their larger neighbours. But what determined which kingdoms succeeded? Geography, greater resources, military structure, or a coherent, dynamic and long-lasting tradition of leadership transmitted successfully from one generation to the next over centuries? The era of settlement and conquest is particularly disputed, and the notion of monolithic ethnic cleansing of Romano Britons by invading Germans is now thought far too simplistic. Possibly peaceful farmers and traders were as crucial as the traditional picture of war bands and heroic leaders played up by literary tradition. But it is clear that leadership was crucial, and in the initial century or two of state formation, dynamic war leaders and statesmen briefly brought leadership of coalitions of smaller kingdoms to states which were later eclipsed, such as Kent, Sussex, and East Anglia. Those larger and better-resourced states, which soon emerged to prominence, particularly the Big Three, had turbulent histories rather than a smooth rise to power, with the dominance of first one and then another, secured and then lost by military means. Wessex, Northumbria and Mercia all achieved temporary dominance within their regions, only to lose it again by dynastic luck, military misjudgment, or a coalition of their enemies. Northumbria was eclipsed temporarily by Mercia after military defeat in 642-55, and permanently after defeat by the Picts in 685, which later battle ended the chance of a northern English state encompassing much of Scotland. Wessex, dominant in the south, was eclipsed twice after 592 and 688. Would Mercia, the leading state through the 8th and early 9th centuries under Æthelbald, Offa the Great and Coenwulf have lost its dominance to Wessex after 825 if its succession had been more stable? Could a stable Mercia, under long-lived rulers, succeeded by competent sons, have prevented the rise of Wessex under Alfred's grandfather, Egbert? And but for the Viking invasions, would Wessex have ever united England? The possible permutations of events, given different leadership choices or luck, are many, and indeed the limited evidence does not prevent us speculating that Anglo-Saxon rule of all England was not inevitable. What if one or more of the post-Roman British states had held on to more of its territory in the 6th or 7th centuries? Chapter 1. Early Anglo-Saxon Kingdoms to circa 800. Part 1. The Setting. An era of personal leadership and creation of new kingdoms. But what if the fortunes of war and politics had turned out differently? A. The problem of the sources. It has become the fashion in recent decades to emphasise the development of the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms of early England in terms of social and economic factors, as opposed to their leadership. The 19th century historians' enthusiasm for history, focusing on the lives of kings and queens, has been downplayed, and in school education, the old system of learning the names of rulers by rote has been replaced by empathising with the lives of their subjects, the ordinary peasant farmers and their families. Assisted by a concentration of resources on archaeology and the excavation of homesteads, the basic details of everyday life have been the mainstay of pre-1066 studies. The complicated details of politics and battles have been neglected, with the additional factor that greater modern understanding of the meagre literary sources poses new questions about them. Just how accurate and reliable are the surviving, often non-contemporary, narratives? To what extent were they written to record details that had been faithfully remembered over generations? And how much were they works of literature and propaganda with a contemporary political purpose? The issue is particularly acute for the era of conquest, itself a problematic concept at variance with basic archaeology, and settlement, the 5th to 7th centuries. The main semi-contemporary British, Welsh source, the De Exidio Britanni of Gildas, 540s, deals in lurid generalisations of mass slaughter and polemic about the sins of the British, and its author clearly saw himself as a latter-day Jeremiah, inveighing against the moral failings of his sinful countrymen that led to merited punishment. He was not writing as an objective historian in the modern sense, or even as a Roman writer such as Tacitus did, but as a polemicist looking to the Old Testament for inspiration. The post-Roman British of his era had lost the greater part of their land to heathen invaders, just as the Jews of Jeremiah's time had lost Israel and were in the process of losing Judah. The parallel was obvious. The cause of this punishment of God's people must be their sins, and thus Gildas, a devout monk, probably writing in southern Britain or Brittany, was bound to play up the extent of the disaster. But his claims of disaster for the British, with towns sacked and farms abandoned in a systematic and countrywide reign of terror by Germanic invaders, are not backed by the evidence on the ground. The amount of fire-related destruction in towns is limited, and it has been pointed out that not every fire can be attributed to attackers, as opposed to accident, which happens to burnt Roman villas too. Pioneering work on the rural landscape shows a major degree of continuity in occupation from post-Roman to Anglo-Saxon settlement, and little sign of devastated farms left vacant for decades. The first English source, the Ecclesiastical History of the English People, was written by another monk, the Venerable Bede, in isolated Northumbria, circa 731, and sought to describe the inevitable triumph of the Roman Catholic missionaries in converting the English. Bede's monastery of Jarrow on the Tyne in northern Northumbria, around 700, was not that remote from events elsewhere despite the geographical location. The kingdom had many contacts with the other English states and bishoprics, and the nearer continent, playing up its role as part of Christendom and its links with the papacy in Rome, particularly under the late 7th century bishopric of the energetic Romanizer St Wilfrid. Its elite, under King Oswy, had made a conscious decision to adopt the Roman religious customs, for example in celebrating Easter at Whitby in 664, to fit in with the continent, and the church kept up its international links. Indeed, from 669, the church in England uniquely had a Greek leader from St Paul's hometown in Sicilia, eastern Anatolia, Archbishop Theodore from Tarsus. Bede was an assiduous collector of facts and emphasised his use of reliable witnesses, but he had a religious purpose in his writing as much as Gildas had, though he seems to have been less credulous about early history and better informed. His account downplayed both the work of Celtic missionaries from Iona, the defeated faction in 664, in the conversion of northern Britain and the survival of the post-Roman British church. If he is to be believed, pre-conversion England was entirely pagan, with no mention of the possibility that Christians using churches, for example that of St Martin at Canterbury, had survived in the Kingdom of Kent into the 6th century. No Christians were referred to in the British kingdoms of the Pennines annexed to Northumbria in the early 7th century. Nor did he point out that, before his hero, St Augustine, and his missionaries arrived from Rome to convert Kent in 597, that King Athelbert's Christian Frankish wife already had an attendant bishop, Liudhard. Both Kent and Northumbria were presented as a pagan tabula rasa when their Roman Christian converters arrived, Augustine in Kent and Paulinus in Northumbria. In secular matters, Bede's list of the major overkings in England in the 7th century, the Bretwaldus, notably left out of the pagan Pender, ruler of the Midlands from circa 625 to 655, and probably more powerful than his Northumbrian contemporaries. The major secular source for pre-900 history, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, was not compiled until the later 9th century, 400 years after the early settlements, and concentrates on events in its home territory, Wessex. It was probably commissioned by King Alfred's court, at a time of renewed threat from the Vikings, to present an inspiring picture of the struggles of the English peoples against the British, and each other, and to play up the role of Alfred's own dynasty. Much of its early detail is formulaic, with the sparse account of the conquest of Wessex suspiciously similar to that of Kent. The only other southern kingdom covered in any detail is Kent, and that mainly at the time of its conquest in the 5th century and the conversion in the 6th century. Sussex, adjacent to Wessex, so presumably reasonably well known to the latter's annalists, is only mentioned during its conquest in the 5th century, and later when its history impinges on Wessex. East Anglia, an important realm, holder of the Bretwaldship in the 620s and location of the major archaeological find of royal treasure at Sutton Hoo, is hardly mentioned, as is Essex. Mercia, crucial in the 7th and 8th centuries and arguably the most powerful kingdom south of the Humber from its unification, circa 630, is neglected, except when its history impinges on Wessex or Northumbria. As with Bede, the career of the pagan Pender is downplayed compared with that of his Christian foes in Northumbria, because Alfred, or other editors, regarded him with disapproval. The annals are very much history from a West Saxon point of view, and we must bear in mind that they may have been collected to inspire the readership and listeners about past heroic successes in an era of Viking attacks. As has been pointed out, there is no mention of apparent Saxon disasters, such as their defeat by the British at Mount Badon, around 500. There is merely a suspicious lacuna in the list of Saxon military successes for the period of 491 to 560, except in Wessex. Again, there are contradictions with the archaeological record, particularly over the early settlement of Hampshire, the alleged cradle of Wessex. There is no archaeological record of a Saxon settlement in Hampshire around 500, when the founder, Cerdic, was apparently active. The majority of 6th century settlements are in the upper and middle Thames Valley, an area whose warfare is not covered in the Chronicle except for a few references in the 570s. For that matter, even the early Welsh sources have been shown to have contemporary political purposes, as with the history attributed to Nennius, circa 829, commissioned for a new dynasty in Gwynedd to play up its predecessor's heroism, and the 10th century Annales Cambriae, compiled at Hywel Dda's court. Skeptics have accordingly had a field day minimising the reliability of all these sources and limiting the amount of written evidence for the period that can be deemed reliable. It is likely that the sources are not as useless as some historians have implied, and that much detail was copied from non-surviving records without much amendation, even if a political spin was put upon it and inconvenient facts were dropped from the record. But it still provides a major note of caution when any assessment of the era of settlement is considered. And for that matter, the first 19th century modern historians to interpret this evidence had their own agenda too. Great progressive Whig historians, such as Freeman and Stubbs, had a motive for presenting a picture of free, racially Germanic Anglo-Saxons creating a distinctly English society without inconvenient Celtic elements. They looked to emulate their 19th century German contemporaries across the German Ocean, North Sea, whence the Anglo-Saxons had come, and to create a founding saga for the British Empire and its democratic institutions. In this respect, the Celtic element in Britain was an irrelevance, and any notion of non-Saxon survival in England to be ignored. The argument sometimes took on ominous racial overtones about the innate superiority of the Germanic Saxons to other peoples. In this interpretation, the 17th century left-wing notion of the post-1066 ruling class as alien Frenchmen imposing a Norman yoke on freedom-loving Saxons was revived. A typical interpretation was that of the historical novelist Charles Kingsley, of the career of Hereward, the post-1066 freedom fighter, as last of the Saxons, the epitome of manly English resistance to tyrannous French invaders. Kingsley and Freeman were as much polemicists as Gildas or Bede were. B. The importance of leadership and a culture of Germanic military leadership. The various small kingdoms in post-Roman Germanic England of the 6th and 7th centuries owed their names to the assorted divisions of the Anglian, Saxon, and Jutish peoples settled in the Danish peninsula and the swamps of northwestern Germany in the 5th century. The three invading peoples of the mid-5th century, as recorded by Bede. In fact, it is not clear whether there was a clear genetic or geographical distinction between them. Did the Jutes come from Jutland? And where precisely was the Angles' homeland? Was it the geographical angle between Germany and the Jutland Peninsula, that is, modern Schleswig-Holstein? What of the 6th century Eastern Roman account of the Frisons, presumably from the Frisian island off Holland, were involved in the conquest? Was this another name for one of Bede's peoples, or for those Saxons not genetically or culturally distinct from the mainlanders who happened to live on the Frisian islands? Were a distinct Frisian people swamped by numerically superior and more culturally aggressive Saxons and forgotten about by later writers? What of the archaeological evidence of close cultural links between the Jutes of Kent and the Franks, seemingly ignored by Bede? The question arises of whether the names that we know the new kingdoms by are an accurate memory of the genetic or cultural makeup of the inhabitants, or just shorthand for the self-perceived allegiance of their leadership. The names may reflect the self-perceived identity of the dominant people in an area by the time of Bede, not that of the real-life 5th and 6th century settlers. What he recorded may be myth as much as accurate fact, and at least be distorted by simplification by later generations after the alleged settlement. Given the recent discoveries about the makeup of English DNA, of which more later, the extent of an influx of settlers from across the North Sea has been questioned. So has the dating of any influx of German Low Countries DNA. How much of what has been traced was pre-Roman, from the so-called Iron Age, When Caesar testifies that some of the tribal Belgae from northern Gaul moved into southern Britain, did the identity of Angles, Saxons, and Jutes reflect the chosen creation myths of the ruling families of family, as recorded by their poets, at the expense of a more muddled and multi-ethnic origin for their followers? So-called tribal identities in post-Roman Europe were sometimes not ethnically monolithic, but considered of a mixture of warriors and their womenfolk from different regions coalescing around a successful leader. Romans and Germans served in the Asian elite around Attila, for example. Did this apply to England too? Were all the emergent kingdoms as ethnically muddled as that of Attila, which was once assumed to be monolithically of Mongolian stock that had migrated all the way from the borders of China? It is not now certain that they were the Xiong Nu Mongolian raiders of Han China in the 2nd and 1st centuries BC, who had been defeated by the Chinese and were assumed to have migrated all the way to the Black Sea by the time they defeated the Goths there in the early 370s. By the same definition, some of the German groups in southeastern England may have been partly British, hence the Romano-British names of the West Saxon founder, Cerdic, and some of his kin and of the Royal House of Lindsay in Lincolnshire. Both kingdoms had capitals, that is, principal royal residences and bishoprics, in former Romano-British regional capitals, Winchester and Lincoln. 5th and 6th century ethnicity is a historical and political minefield, and all that can be said is that the initial approaches of 19th century historians were too simplistic and were often influenced by their own contemporary notions of nationhood. Indeed, nowadays, some historians even think that the long-cherished differences between archaeological finds for Romano-British and Germanic peoples, grave goods, and methods of burial in particular, reflect cultural fashion as much as ethnicity. Given the likely mixture of ethnic origin for the populace of some kingdoms, were these so-called Saxon territories ever settled exclusively by people from Saxony, that is, Old Saxony in Lower Northwest Germany, or the Jutish territories from Jutland? And how and why did the name of the Frisians, Frisones, become submerged in those of Angles, Saxons, and Jutes? Creating a sense of identity was important, and the emergence of patriotic legends of identity focusing on a dynasty can be seen in the example of the most successful people of the later 4th and 5th centuries, the Goths. The Gothic history, Jetica, of Jordanes, reflects their self-image by circa 500 and is centred on the Amal dynasty. The semi-Romanized Goths in conquered Italy are the most visible sign of this tendency, but it seems to apply across many other peoples, as in England with the founding myths of Kent, centred on Hengist, and the Anglian Mercians, centred on their continental ancestor, King Offa. Crucially, when all this dynastic mythology was created, no ambitious literary spinner for a new post-Roman kingship could create a history of ancient ruling royal families who had held power for centuries, giving an impression of antiquity and stability. The post-Roman kingship of the Germanic states in ex-Roman lands was new, and everyone knew it, though some lengthy dynastic history was to be created for non-Roman Denmark by Saxo Grammaticus. The creation of any similar foundation myths and heroic sagas for the English states is more problematic, but it would seem that Hengist in Kent, not even a definitively historical character, benefited from this. Possibly the arrival and battles of Cerdic, founder of the West Saxon kingdom, had a similar heroic saga created about it, and this was used by the compilers of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle nearly 400 years later. Given the limited extent of lay literacy in 6th to 9th century England, these stories may have been orally preserved and possibly embellished. The contrast between post-Roman Britain and post-Roman Gaul is unclear, but the survival of sub-Roman Latinate names for the local Gallic 6th century aristocracy and its control of church offices is apparent. So is literary culture. For Gaul, we have the detailed and erudite historical work of Bishop Gregory of Tours. But for Britain, we have the vague and often obscure Jeremiad of the monk Gildas, whose personal data and location are uncertain. The degree of historical knowledge of the later Roman period displayed by Gildas is restricted. He mixes up the time and purpose of the building of Hadrian's Wall and thinks that Magnus Maximus, the Western imperial usurper from Britain who was killed in 388, not Constantine III, 407, was the man who took the last Roman troops from Britain. So clearly the degree of survival of literary history books in this region, as opposed to Gregory's, was limited. He had no access in monastic libraries to 5th century Roman sources, such as Orosius and Olympiodorus. At least in the Mediterranean countries, there was a substantial survival of the Roman population, and even of their urban civilization and traditions, now centred on the Catholic Church. The extent of Romano-Celtic survival in English, southeastern Britain, has been disputed, and it cannot be linked conclusively to the eclipse of the Roman lingua franca, Latin, as we cannot be sure that all the post-Roman populace spoke that tongue, rather than one or more Brittonic languages, presumably including Proto-Welsh. There were identical people of British origin in Wessex in the 690s, as seen from Ine's Law Code, though they were treated as second-class citizens and not given the same legal worth as Saxons. The lack of evidence makes it unclear how and where pre-German inhabitants survived as a distinct and resilient culture, but some definitely did in remote and mountainous areas of Gaul and Spain. For example, the pre-Roman Vascones, the Basques. Bede's language would seem to imply a form of genocide of Britons in some conquered areas of Northumbria, but this may be myth or simplification. It was writing over 100 years after the creation of the kingdom across the north by Aethelfrith. The extinction of pre-Anglian Christianity in the north by the pagan Northumbrians requiring reconversion by the 7th century Iona and Canterbury missionaries is also problematic. But Bede, the greatest and only surviving English historian of the age, was a German in ethnic identity, with limited knowledge of pre-conquest Britain. The Gallic Gregory of Tours was a Romano-Gaul of distinguished noble lineage, looking back to the Christian Roman Empire. Bede had little knowledge of Roman Britain, and what he did have was primarily religious, possibly derived from surviving hagiographies of the Romano-British saints, such as Alban. Nor did he have a good opinion of the British Church, whose contribution to post-Roman life he minimises in his history. His Roman missionary hero, St. Augustine, comes to evangelise a totally pagan people and has little contact with the Welsh Church, and there is no hint that his heroic King Edwin of Northumbria had lived as an exile in Christian Gwynedd in Wales before he converted to Roman Christianity. The success of a military organised group of Germans under a dynamic leader in establishing a state depended on the skill and luck of the leaders in carving out, and keeping, a viable territory. Numerous peoples identified in the written records of the 5th century as participants in the invasions, for example the Scyrians and Heruls, failed to establish a new territory. A few states were personal rather than tribal in their nomenclature, as with the mixed German following of the Scyrian warlord Odovasar in Italy, who overthrew the last Roman government there in 476, but succumbed to Theodoric the East Goth, Ostrogoth, in 491-93. The anonymous small-scale kingdoms of the Riparian Franks in the Rhine Valley were overrun by their Salian rivals under the Merovingian line between circa 500 and 540, as was the small kingdom of the Burgundians in Savoy. The small and isolated Suevic kingdom in Galicia, Spain, was overthrown by its more powerful Visigothic neighbours. The Ostrogothic kingdom was overrun by the East Roman armies as they reconquered Italy in 535-39, made a heroic effort to recover its territory under Totila, and finally succumbed in 553-54. The Gothic officers notably offered their vacant throne at one point to their conqueror, Belisarius, showing their respect for his military skill and honest dealing. The fact that there was such a prolonged fight against the Eastern Roman armies argues for a substantial esprit de corps and sense of identity by the Gothic military elite, besides the personal charisma and competence of their leader Totila. The war did not end with his death in 552 either. A series of crushing military defeats by the eastern general Narses, an aging eunuch dispatched west by Justinian in place of the brilliant but distrusted Belisarius, probably crushed the Gothic elite and left the survivors powerless, though the war left Italy economically ruined too. Their state vanished from history, and the next and more long-lasting German kingdom in northern Italy was created by the new wave of Lombard invaders from 568. In Gaul, the kingdom of the Burgundians, set up in the upper Rhone region by Attius to settle refugees from Attila in 442, was overrun by Clovis' sons in the mid-6th century and vanished as a distinct ethnic entity. The Franks' greater resources and better leadership prevailed, but the notion of a separate kingdom, with the Burgundian name to mark its identity, continued under Frankish royal leaders for centuries. Similarly, the ex-Gothic lands south of the Loire were overrun by Clovis in 507 and politically incorporated into Francia. But an often autonomous sub-kingdom of Aquitaine continued to exist, and after the eclipse of the Carolingian state in the later 9th century, became a separate, hereditary duchy. In England, the notion of a defeated kingdom surviving as an autonomous entity under kings from the conqueror's royal family can be seen in Deira, conquered by Æthelfrith of Bernicia circa 604 to create Northumbria, but having separate rulers for much of the 7th century until 679. Did the fact that even powerful warlords, Oswald and Oswy of Northumbria, Bernician in origin, but with a Deiran mother, felt obliged to retain a Deiran sub-kingdom under their genealogically Deiran cousins, reflect a powerful localism in the region? The Deiran sub-kingdom lasted even under the years of Oswy's and his sons Egfrith's relative security, after their defeat of Mercia in 655 until 679, albeit under their own sons and brothers. Most of the new mini-kingdoms of the 6th and 7th centuries survived, if only as the names of counties, for example Sussex and Essex, though we lose sight of their royal families, whose menfolk were at best sub-kings or governors, duces or earldermen, by the 8th century. There was no drastic abolition of the local political entities, as they were absorbed by their powerful neighbours, which suggests the centralising warlords, such as Offa and Coenwulf of Mercia, had to respect local opinion. Even rebellious Kent, which had broken away from Mercia at least twice before final subjugation in 798, survived as a distinct sub-kingdom under Mercian nominees in 798-825, and thereafter became a sub-kingdom within its next conqueror, Wessex. Both Coenwulf of Mercia and Egbert of Wessex entrusted newly conquered Kent to a close relative, brother and son. East Anglia, whose king, St. Ethelbert, was executed in dubious circumstances by Offa of Mercia in 794 and its separate coinage suppressed, a usual sign of political extinction, re-emerged under new kings in the 820s. The division of Northumbria into Deira and Bernicia, aided by the difficulty of one man ruling a large state stretching from Forth to Humber, re-emerged in the 870s as the Vikings overran and settled Deira, but a new Bernician state emerged, ruled by the noble dynasty of Bamborough. Only Wiltshire, basically Gloucestershire and Worcestershire, and Magansetan, basically Herefordshire and Shropshire, suppressed by Mercia in the 8th century, vanished as distinct subregions within their overlord. The eventual success stories were the larger kingdoms, among whom two, Mercia and Northumbria, had not existed in the 6th century. Unlike in Francia, where the Merovingians of Clovis dynasty overran the Ripuarian Franks and Burgundians in the early mid-6th century and later Bavaria, neither of these kingdoms absorbed all its neighbours. In all these cases, the crucial cement that created and held together a new state in this era of political flux, was leadership. But what if these most successful states had not had such a run of good luck in competent leadership? C. Identity, founders, and the question of the English sub-kingdoms, the creations of self-made warlords, or of a group of settlers. The question of who founded the English kingdoms has been challenged in the past century. It used to be assumed that the stories in Bede, Nennius, and the Chronicle of Great Leaders setting up each kingdom were reasonably accurate, though written down centuries later. The earliest of them, Hengest of Kent, was active, if he existed, around the 440s, and our earliest written evidence is nearly 300 years later. Accordingly, modern mythographers and interpreters of post-Roman authors have challenged the reliability of the evidence. Did their informants remember the basic details of the origin of these kingdoms, preserved by oral tradition? Or was it all romantic legend, spun to give the inhabitants of these kingdoms a sense of identity and a heroic past? Did the creation of a heroic founding ancestor in the 6th or 7th centuries serve to bolster the contemporary claims to authority of their alleged descendants, the current kings? The problem is similar to that of the Trojan War myths in ancient Greece, where the poems of Homer, whoever he was, were probably composed orally in the 8th century BC, but the Siege of Troy would have taken place before 1200 BC. In Wales, the legendary warrior hero Arthur would have been active around AD 500, but the first literary account by Nennius is dated to the 820s. In Ireland, the mythical heroes of the Ulster cycle, such as Cuchulainn, would have been active in the 1st or 2nd centuries AD, and Finn McCool and the Fauna in the 3rd. Nothing was written down for hundreds of years. Accordingly, sceptics have had a field day analysing the political motives of the writers to whom we owe the information and claiming that they had no notion of objective history. The jury is still out on this question, but it is more likely, as with Troy, that some originals lie behind the later myths, however distorted. Political structures such as the new Anglo-Saxon kingdoms are more often created by dynamic individuals than by committees of cooperating delegates. The very nature of the new states, erected in lands formerly ruled by shadowy post-Roman authorities, suggest military activity rather than entirely peaceful penetration by groups of farmers or traders. The latter is more likely, where no foundation myth or clear dynastic founder is recorded, as in Essex. Some names of founders of new Germanic kingdoms may have been invented by later mythographers as symbols of a precarious national identity, and given impossibly heroic careers that owed much to appropriated legends, for example Hengest in Kent. The latter is now often regarded as a mythical figure, with the story of his rise from a minor mercenary captain of British High King Vortigern to a successful rebel and King of Kent taken as a romantic fabrication. His most notorious trick, having his followers hide their long knives up their sleeves at a peace summit, and then pulling them out to kill the British delegates, is a staple of contemporary mythology. Indeed, his name means stallion, rather than being a given name, and it probably refers to his standard of the white horse, taken as the Saxon symbol in later myths. Horsa, that is horse, is an unlikely name for his fellow leader, and it is not clear if Horsa or Isk was Hengist's lieutenant in his early battles, nor is the date of Hengist's invasion clear. The 9th century British sources would indicate that he landed in the late 420s, while Bede places it at 449. But the idea of a hired captain of Germanic federates revolting against his post-Roman royal employer and carving out his own kingdom is logical for the turbulent world of the 5th century. And there are several examples of it on the continent, for example Alaric. Nor should it be assumed that the romantic story of Hengist displaying his daughter Rowena to Vortigern, arousing his interest, and craftily giving her to the king as his second wife, is just a later literary invention. It may be invented, but it is plausible enough, and would account for the breach between Vortigern and his already adult son and heir Vortimer, who 9th-century Welsh writer Nennius cites as the British war leader who attempted to drive Hengist out of Kent. The story has Vortimer succeeding, but then dying, allegedly poisoned by Rowena on Hengist's behalf, and Vortigern recalling Hengist. The main problem is that the archaeology of Kent is at variance with the idea of a sudden unilateral seizure of land by a large force of Germanic immigrants. The career of Cerdic, a British name, Ceredig, as founder of the West Saxon royal house is equally problematic, and it is probable that the Germanic genealogy that the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, written up to circa 890, gives him is a literary invention. A founder hero of a Saxon kingdom, claiming to lead all England against the Vikings, could hardly be admitted to be a Briton, and there have been claims by recent historians that the consistent pre-8th century naming of the West Saxon kingdom as that of the Gervisi, not the West Saxons, indicates that it was not an exclusively Germanic polity in the 6th and 7th centuries. The obscure name, Gervisi, apparently means confederates, which could indicate a multi-ethnic creation by Britons, Jutes, in the New Forest region, and Saxons, and the archaeology indicates a continuing Romano-British cultural presence in Cerdic's alleged heartland of Hampshire in the early 6th century, as well as in Dorset until the 7th century. The first Saxon artifacts, from around 500, are found close to the still-occupied post-Roman town of Winchester, Venta Belgarum, implying people, traders or mercenaries and their families, living there by agreement with the locals. British names of kings continue through the 6th century. Cerdic's son or grandson, Cernic, that is, Cunerix, into the later 7th century, Cadwalla, that is, Cadwallon. The heaviest area of Saxon settlement in the early middle 6th century was in the Thames Valley, which the Chronicle does not mention as an area of West Saxon military activity until the 570s. Did the West Saxon founders really set up a Germanic state, or was it a mixed British-Jutish-Saxon state that only acquired a major Saxon ethnic component when it moved into the Thames Valley under King Solin after 560. The role of Cerdic may be different in reality than it is in the patriotic West Saxon legend of Alfred's time, when it would have been unthinkable for the editors of the Chronicle to accept that he was not a Saxon by ethnicity, as they were seeking to show the heroic past of their kingdom and royal dynasty to inspire a Saxon people threatened by Viking invasion. Alfred could hardly be a suitable leader for the national English resistance, Mercian as well as West Saxon, if his dynasty's founder was not even Saxon. Though it is more likely that the notion of Cerdic as a Saxon, not a mixed-race warlord, was already established by Alfred's time, not a deliberate fraud. Given the lack of Germanic archaeological sites in 6th-century Hampshire, at the least, he ruled a mixed people, and he and his British-named successor, Cernic, Cunerix, possibly had British mothers and wives. The Chronicle suspiciously gives Cerdic a 40-year career, 494 to 534, as it does Hengist, 449 to 488. Like Hengist, he landed sometime before, taking the kingdom, and was assisted by a younger colleague, the founder's sons being Esc in Kent and Cernic in Wessex. Is the duplication due to historical fact or to Saxon poets annexing one man's mythical career for another's? We do not even have the basic details of the careers of other dynastic founders, as in East Anglia or Mercia, and cannot tell if they were established by one man or by a group of autonomous local warlords whose lands later coalesced into one kingdom. The dating of the first Germanic artifacts in both these states is mid-late 5th century, but the existing royal genealogies only commence with shadowy kings datable to sometime in the mid-6th century. Were the many separate local peoples of Mercia originally mini-kingdoms, and ditto the North folk and South folk of East Anglia? All that is recorded of Ida of Bernicia is that he took the fortress of Bamburgh in 547, and it is not clear how the succession to this isolated kingdom descended until the early 590s. No kings of the South Saxons are recorded for a century and a half after the founder, Ael, So did the kingship lapse after the need for a military leader during the conquest passed. But it is probably significant that a mid-6th century king of Kent, or Menric, was called after the great Gothic ruler of the 370s, destroyed by the Huns, and an East Anglian king, was called after Totila, the current Ostrogothic war hero of the 540s. Their parents evidently sought inspiration from the great continental German heroes and were aware of their careers, and their perceived cultural identity was Germanic. The pre-conquest names of rulers of assorted peoples were probably manufactured, as with the ancestral Anglo-Saxon dynastic descent from the god Woden, though possibly the pre-conquest continental Anglian king Offa of Angle was a real person. It is hard to find successful new kingdoms in the 5th to 8th centuries which have no clear record of dynamic leadership or individual sovereigns. This may not date to the time when archaeology shows the first settlements as occurring. In Mercia, there was extensive settlement in the Trent Valley in the later 5th century and early 6th century, but the ruling kin cannot be dated beyond circa 550, and the first known kings of all Mercia only appear in the 580s. There are exceptions where settlement may have been mainly peaceful, and there is a degree of continuity of occupation of excavated farmsteads with the post-Roman situation, for example East Anglia. But it is no use assuming from this that there was no tension, eviction, and conquest, and thus no need for a new Germanic war band commanders. If that were so, why is there no major survival of Romano-British names in the area? Why were the Welsh, a name equivalent to foreigner, 10th century slave, which is significant, treated as second-class citizens in the West Saxon law codes if they had not been conquered by force? The continuity of land use may well imply that estates were taken over quickly as coherent, recognisable units and were put into use as agricultural land, again with only a short break, with or without some of the original tenants staying on. But they were still taken over by culturally distinct new owners, as seen by the influx of Germanic goods into the east of England in the years from circa 450 to 550, with most of the earliest artefacts found near the coasts. Crucial decisions of conquest and inter-district warfare were clearly taken by one war leader to whom warriors could rally, or occasionally two, as with the Goths in 376, though a council of the heads of dominant families could delegate this task to a capable warrior for a short-term crisis if there was no ongoing need for military leadership. The fact that the dynastic lists of East Anglia do not include any rulers from the 5th century, when settlement was underway, suggests that there was no permanent kingship or any unified command in the area at this time, unless a leader was forgotten, deliberately, by his supplanters. Some peoples occupying a specific geographic region lacked kings and seem to have been decentralised under local warlords, such as the old Saxon lands on the Lower Elbe, or the new settlements of the Slav peoples in Eastern Europe, from the Baltic to the Greek lands. It is possible that the same applies to mini-kingdoms or peoples in Anglo-Saxon England, of whom no dynastic record survives, such as the Middle Saxons of Middlesex or the 5th century North and South folks of East Anglia. Bede reckoned that there were provincii, or regions, as a level of administrative organisation below that of the kingdoms. This fits his picture. This would also apply to the smaller local peoples of a district who had a distinct identity but had no need for long-term leadership on account of a largely peaceful history. There may have been no need for leadership, except in occasional warfare, and thus, when a territory had been conquered, its early leadership lapsed into a decentralised network of autonomous communities. It remains at issue whether local mini-states, later absorbed into bigger kingdoms, which appear to have been named after one man, for example Hastings, East Sussex, as Hastur's people, were named after a conquering war leader or not. There are many districts with this distinct Ingers terminology in the southeast, for example the Roddings and Barking in western Essex and Sonning in the Middle Thames Valley, and no evidence of sustained local warfare. The concept of there having one founder, The man whose name was used in the area's identification may be later historians' rationalisation of conquest as necessarily being led by a commander, and an artificial creation of the alleged founder from the name of a local grouping. It has been suggested that these regions owed their distinctive identity either to being settled by a coherent group dominated by one kin, possibly related families moving in as a group or possibly only cooperating later in self-defence, or to taking over an already distinct post-Roman administrative district, a town, as with Great Chesterford in the Fens, or a rural district, Padgus. There is also the question of those mini-states, later absorbed into larger ones, whose names seem more clearly to indicate a geographical rather than a personal identity. The greatest number of these are in Mercia, a kingdom only created circa 580, according to later royal genealogies, and so not coeval with settlement. Archaeology shows widespread Germanic settlement in the lower Trent Valley by the early 6th century, but there is no record of who ruled these areas at the time. As seen from the 7th century tribal hidage, the kingdom included such distinct peoples based in distinct areas as the Pecceton, the Peak District, Rossenceton, Wrekin, Shropshire, and Arrowceton, River Arrow, Warwickshire, along with the Hakani, or putative West Mercians of Worcestershire. These appear to be based on geographical identity, which begs the question of whether the locals had seen themselves in that context as a separate people from their arrival, or if that identity was created for them by the new Kingdom of Mercia for administrative convenience. In the cases of certain provinciae, as Bede calls them, there is an apparent link with a previous Roman unit, for example the Rosenceton, based around Viriconium, which was still inhabited in the 6th century, and the Magonceton of Herefordshire, based around Magnus, Kenchester. The argument about taking over coherent Roman units probably applies to their new Anglo-Saxon identity. There is also a question over the surprising names of the kings of the two main West Mercian subkingdoms, Whitcher and Magonceton. The 7th century kings of Whitcher, based around Winchcombe in Gloucestershire, a long way from Bernicia, have Bernician names, for example, Urnfrith and Oswald. Is this coincidence, or were they Bernician in origin, refugees from the ruthless state-builder Aethelfrith, who sought new lands in a distant kingdom? The first recorded king of Magonceton, Merewol, was supposedly a son of Pender of Mercia, but his name means noble Welshman. Was he a son of Pender by his legendary Welsh wife, Heledd of Powys, or a Welsh adopted son or stepson? The royal charters show that Merewol's family claimed to be kin to Pender's family and to the Mercian royal's Kentish in-laws. The state appears to have centred around a Roman administrative unit, possibly of the town of Magnus, Kenchester, near Hereford, and there is no archaeological evidence of Germanic settlers pre-650, so it was probably ethnically mainly British Welsh. No lines of rulers, hereditary or otherwise, are recorded for the Mercian substates, although they presumably supplied most of the juices, governors, not of royal rank, by the normal Latin translation, recorded in the Mercian hegemony by Bede for circa 655. Most of the 30 sub-kings who he says fought for King Pender at the Battle of Winwood must have come from within Mercia, given that his non-Mercian allies, for example East Anglia, still had full royal status. It may be that they were decentralised local kindreds who only needed a ruler in times of war, as with the earlier Germanic peoples recorded by Tacitus in Germany in the 1st century, who only elected special war leaders and otherwise relied on judges. Alternatively, the triumphant central kingship of Mercia, established circa 580, may have suppressed all record of its defeated local rivals, and no lists of kings have survived to be recorded in later books. However they were governed, such mini-states were at serious risk of being conquered by aggressive, predatory neighbours with larger armies with determined leadership, as the Franks did to the old Saxons in the mid-late 8th century. The most famed warlord of early Mercia, Pender, may well have conquered his Midlands rivals from the local peoples during his reign from circa 625 to 655, and Cadwalla of Wessex similarly suppressed assorted sub-kings recorded for mid-7th century Wessex during his dynamic reign in 685-88. We know that Northumbria arose from a union of Bernicia, north of the Tees, with Deira, south of it, first imposed by conquest by Athelfrith of Bernicia, circa 604, but with the Deirans retaining sub-kings up to 679. Sussex was reduced to a virtual province of its new overlord, Mercia, during the 7th century, and its kings were forced down in rank from Reggie to Deuces. Offa and Conewulf of Mercia endeavoured to force the same subjection on Kent, conquered by force circa 785, in revolt 796-98, then a Mercian sub-kingdom up to 807, and absorbed into Mercia from 807-825. The sub-kings of Mercia's southwestern vassals, Wiltshire, Worcestershire and Gloucestershire, and Magan Seton, Herefordshire and Shropshire, were abolished sometime in the early 8th century. It seems to have been a matter of established royal Mercian policy at the time of Mercia's greatness to reduce these sub-rulers from their original high rank, and it applied to Mercia's distant vassal Sussex too, as its kings are referred to as Deuces after 772. How many more such conquests and annexations of small kingdoms went unrecorded? The pre-5th century British, a precedent for the Anglo-Saxon states? Unexpected continuity, or similar situations for both? There is some similarity between the situation of the rival kingdoms of early Anglo-Saxon England and the multiplicity of tribal states that existed before the Roman conquest. Indeed, continuity existed in terms of names. Kent comes from the original British name for the region, recorded by Caesar. Within pre-Roman Celtic Britain, the scant literary evidence is backed up by coinage. It seems that a Germanic-style hegemonic tribal kingdom north of the Lower Thames, that of Catavellauni, was newly dominant under an aggressive leader, the eponymous Cassivellaunus, when Caesar landed in 55 BC and was still being resisted by its neighbours. Their loyalty could not be taken for granted, and some preferred allying with Rome to preserve their independence. After Caesar's brief expeditions, the Catavellani resumed their expansion under Cunobelinus and overran both the Trinovantes of Essex and the Belgae south of the Thames. The Trinovantian kingdom became a sub-kingdom of the Catavellani, given to a prince of the ruling house, and when Cunobelinus died, circa 40 AD, he was succeeded by two sons as joint kings, Caratacus and Tassiovanus. In modern Hampshire, and possibly Sussex, the kingdom of the Atrebates was centred on the large pre-Roman proto-urban settlement, Oppidum of Caleva, Silchester, in North Hampshire, one of the few pre-Roman and Roman towns not to survive into the Anglo-Saxon era as the centre of an administrative region. The Atrebates and their neighbours, the Belgae, had probably fought over control of Hampshire in the 1st century BC, with the Belgae, new arrivals from the continent according to Caesar, seizing the south and setting up their principal town at Venta Belgarum, Winchester. One or two Atrebatic kings took refuge at Augustus' court in Rome in the first decade or so AD, according to Roman inscriptions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.